Det andra världskriget färgar fortfarande det brittiska samhället. Inte oväntat är en av årets mest populära böcker, Solens rike, en krigsskildring. Det som överraskar är att boken är skriven av Jim Ballard, en av science fiction-litteraturens mest kända författare, och att den handlar om hans egen barndom i krigets Kina. Det kan tyckas ironiskt att det är först med den här boken som framtidsvisionären Ballard fått sitt genombrott hos den stora publiken.
If you'd come here 5 years ago, you would have found 3 children whom I brought up by myself after my wife died 20 years ago. And this was their nursery where they watched television and had all their toys. Now I'm alone here. The children have grown up. So in a way, this is my nursery. There's even an exercise bicycle, which sadly to say, it has the lowest mileage of any exercise bicycle in London. This is where I come in the evenings, but where I really, my real existence as a writer is in this room here. This is where my imagination dwells. This is my study, and it's always been my private room. It's at that desk where I've written my fiction for the last, I think almost every novel I've written and almost all my entire output of fiction has been written in sitting at that desk, looking out on that little garden. I was born in Shanghai, in China, in 1930. I was the son of British parents who'd emigrated from England in the late 1920s. My father was in charge of a British business manufacturing textiles, and I lived a typical life in the international settlement until 1937, when I was 7 years old. The Japanese declared war on China, and they invaded the coastal areas of China.
Under cover of smokescreen, Nippon's aggressors thundered into China in defiance of all law. Few could foresee in this arrogant aggression the beginning, the testing ground, for the Holocaust of World War II that was to lay so much of the earth to ruin.
The Japanese occupied all the major cities, though in the case of Shanghai, they respected the international settlement, which was a small section in the middle of Shanghai. There I am with my mother, with some friends on the Bund at Shanghai. There I am on a bike. After Pearl Harbor in December 1941, the Japanese forces rolled their tanks through the streets one morning and took over the city. And my book, Empire of the Sun, describes the adventures of a boy of my own age called Jim, who finds that the book opens on the eve of the day before Pearl Harbor, and he finds that in the confusion when the Japanese enter the city, that he is separated from his parents. He returns to his family house, which is now empty, waiting for his parents to return. When they don't appear, he gradually begins to realize that he's on his own. He then is forced to live like a sort of young Robinson Crusoe, almost, in the big houses of the western suburbs of Shanghai, living on cocktail biscuits and scraps left over from the lives led by these now vanished British and Americans. Eventually, after numerous adventures, he is captured by the Japanese and finds his way to Longhua camp. An important part of the novel is, of course, Jim's whole relationship with the camp that he finds himself in for 3 years. For Jim, it represents complete security. It's the only secure world that he has known. And he is, as the war draws to a close, and it's clear that the Japanese are losing the war, he becomes more and more worried. He is terrified of what will happen to them when the Japanese are no longer guarding the camp. And this, of course, is what happened in fact. We in our camp at Lunghwa faced a period of greatest danger when the Japanese had surrendered, and we were left on our own, 2,000 people with no food, no supplies, and the Americans 300 miles away. There was a very uneasy period of about a month before the Americans finally arrived. And for Jim, his whole attitude towards imprisonment and security and safety is completely unlike the conventional picture that people have of sort of liberation and rescue that we generally see in films about the war.
Jim vill inte lämna fånglägret när japanerna överger det. Han vägrar att tro att kriget är slut.
I'd like to think, because of course I'm very closely identified with this young hero, who in many respects is myself, I think he perceives, he recognizes some kind of truth about the nature of war. I mean, he firmly believes, for example, that World War II may have ended, but with its end and the dropping of the atom bomb, World War III has actually begun. And this is what he feels, that none of the adults around him, none of his fellow prisoners, recognize. They are still thinking in old categories of armistice days and red poppies and lapels and all these sort of sentimental ideas that people have about war and peace and so on. He realizes that war in the mid 20th century and in the late 20th century to come is endemic to the human condition, and that the human beings must accept this, that they're deluding themselves by imagining that peace will ever come.
Efter kriget skickas Jim till England för att studera. Mötet med hemlandet blev en chock för honom.
Yes, it was. It was a terrible shock from which I've never really recovered. I think the whole of the last nearly 40 years has been, on my part, an attempt to get over the shock. And I mean, many people have asked me why it took me 40 years to write Empire of the Sun, which is a very long time to wait. And I think partly the reason is that those experiences took a long time to forget and a long time to remember. They took 20 years to forget and then another 20 years to remember. But I think that I was in a lot of my fiction, a lot of my novels, right from my first novel, The Drowned World, I was really writing about the war experiences that I went through, but in disguised form.
I bok efter bok har Jim Ballard beskrivit vår civilisations sönderfall. En katastrofsituation som till exempel torka eller översvämning sätter allt ur funktion. Kvar blir ett tyst och ödsligt landskap med tomma hotell, torra simbassänger, övergivna bilar där människan måste slåss för sin överlevnad. Ett landskap som säkert påminner om krigets Shanghai.
I didn't feel in the 1950s that the English landscape was one I could write about. English society struck me as extremely uninteresting in every respect, class-ridden, obsessed with nostalgia for a vanished empire. I was very aware when I came to England in 1946 that the light here was different. It was much darker. It was much greyer. That it was a puritanical country where people were led extremely rigid and closed lives, and everybody knew his place on the social ladder. And the kind of fiction, the novels that were being written, were all about the English class structure. They were all about little nuances of social distinctions, which the English were obsessed with, and to some extent still are. I wanted to write a kind of fiction that broke away from this very old-fashioned, looking backward sort of fiction. I wanted a fiction that was about, never mind the future, but was about the present day. It seemed to me that English fiction wasn't even about the present day. And the 50s, it seemed to me, were a time of enormous change. The world we live in now, the world of international jet travel, package holidays, computers, installment buying, the whole communications landscape that we inhabit, dominated by television, mass advertising, politics conducted as a branch of advertising. All this was being created in the 1950s. The rails were being laid down along which Western Europe would run in the next 20 or 30 years. I wanted to write about this. I wanted to write about change and possibility. I wanted to write about the next 5 minutes, not the last 30 years. And the only form of fiction that it seemed to me that had the vocabulary of ideas to deal with the next 5 minutes was science fiction. Now, I wasn't interested in interplanetary travel, time travel, outer space. That didn't interest me at all, and I've never written a science fiction set in outer space or millions of years in the future. I wanted a science fiction for the present day. It seemed to me when I started writing in the late 50s and early 60s that the future was a better key to the present than the past. And one had to look at the next 5 minutes to understand what was going on now.
Under 70-talet skrev Ballard en serie böcker om människans förhållande till det teknologiska landskap som vuxit upp omkring henne. I en av dessa böcker råkar en medelålders arkitekt ut för en bilolycka. Han mister kontrollen över sin Jaguar mitt på motorvägen. Bilen slungas över vägräcket och ner på en av dessa överblivna jordbitar som finns mellan vägbanorna. Arkitekten försöker förgäves ta sig därifrån. Han är skadad efter olyckan och trafiken är intensiv. Så småningom ger han upp och ägnar sig åt att upptäcka den ö han hamnat på. Mitt i trafikvimlet är han lika isolerad som någonsin Robinson Crusoe.
I'd like to think that I worked in the area of myths, dreams, legends, which seemed to me to touch the real nature of our experience, both as private individuals with our own private dreams and as members of a society. And societies have their dreams too. In fact, what is so strange about the world we inhabit today is the way in which fiction and reality have become reversed. That, say 20, 30, 40 years ago, everybody had a clear idea of the world of reality was the external world around you, the world of work and industry, commerce. The world of fantasy and the imagination was the world inside our heads, our private dreams and hopes for the future and so on. Now that's been reversed. Now we're living in a world that is almost the external landscapes of our world are almost entirely fictional, made up of advertising and publicity, an artificial man-made landscape. The only point of reality we each of us have is the point of reality inside our heads. Our own obsessions are all we have.
Långt senare, när han satt på sin balkong och grillade hunden, tänkte Dr. Leng tillbaka på den senaste tidens ovanliga händelser. Så börjar Ballards framtidsvision av livet i ett modernt bostadsområde. En vårdslöst kastad champagneflaska är den första av en serie våldshandlingar som leder till inbördeskrig i höghuset. De lägre våningarna kämpar mot de högre. Barnfamiljerna mot hundägarna. Allting sätts ur funktion och våldet sprider sig till de kringliggande husen.
It seems to me that the sort of world we live in needs a certain amount of oil to make the wheels go around. In the 60s, sex provided that role. Now, in our landscape, sex is no longer a new frontier. You get the impression almost that sex has died out, doesn't take place anymore. The landscape, the media landscape that we inhabit, this enormous novel we're living inside, thrives on sensation. It needs sensation to sustain itself. We're rather in the position of a sort of drowsing animal drugged by some powerful narcotic agent who needs electric shocks to keep it awake. And the electric shocks are provided by violence today, by violent imagery of one sort or another, whether it's plane crashes or train crashes, hijacks or just, you know, car crashes from our locals. City streets.
Ballard menar att det teknologiska landskapet omkring oss väcker till liv okända drifter. Bilvraket ser han som en symbol för kollisionen mellan individen och teknologin. Han menar att det stora antalet bilolyckor talar för att vi djupt i vårt omedvetna önskar den här sammanstötningen. I sin originellaste bok, Crash, skildrar han bilolyckan som erotisk upplevelse. Boken handlar om en man som planerar sin egen dödsolycka med pervers detaljrikedom. Bilen ska kollidera i en exakt uträknad vinkel med en känd filmstjärnas limousin på motorvägen över flygplatsen. Varje blodstänk, varje skada på chassit är noggrant uttänkt. Man kan likna Ballards sätt att arbeta med en vetenskapsmans. Han lägger fram en teori och testar sedan verkligheten mot den. Läsaren får avgöra om teorin är riktig eller ej. Ballards framtidsvisioner ligger bara 5 minuter framåt i tiden. Snart är vi där. Eller vi är redan där. Den här förorten i norra London, där nyligen rasbråk förekommit, fick på 60-talet pris för bästa bostadsområde. Thank you. 60-talets framtidsdröm har blivit dagens mardröm. Hur ser vår framtid ut?
It seems to me that what most of us have to fear for the future is not that something terrible is going to happen, but rather that nothing is going to happen, that we may live, or my children may well live, in a boring world, in what I would call an eventless world, a world where nothing happens. And this will lead, this is what I fear will happen, is that this will lead to the atrophy of the imagination. I felt this very strongly, oddly enough, some years ago when I was taken on a long drive through West Germany. And it struck me that here was this immaculate country of beautiful, clean streets and houses where every driveway had a BMW. And even a drifting leaf in the street looked as if it had too much freedom. I felt that, you know, this might be, if you want an image of what the future is going to look like, it will be a suburb of Dusseldorf. And that might not be a good thing for the human spirit. One sees that coming over here a bit. It's, if the imagination dies, then it may be that, of course, the only area in which the imagination will continue to live will be in the area of psychopathology. That psychopathology may become the last repository of the human imagination. In one of my books, The Atrocity Exhibition, I even make the suggestion that psychopathology should be kept alive as the last reservoir, like a nature reserve in Africa, the last reservoir of the human imagination. There's no doubt that the surrealist painters have had a far bigger influence on me than any writers have done. I regard surrealism as really the greatest imaginative adventure of the 20th century. I think the surrealist movement is very misunderstood. People think it's a movement in painting inspired by fantasy, but in fact that's not true. The surrealists were all very interested in science, in optics and photography. And their main inspiration, of course, was psychoanalysis. And I think that combination of science and the imagination is very close to my own writing. And of course, it has many affinities with science fiction itself. In many ways, I believe that science fiction is the authentic literature of the 20th century. I think it's unfortunate that science fiction is boxed off into its own little compartment. It seems to me a little ironic that I've had, after something like nearly 30 years as a writer, my first real success has been with a book that isn't science fiction, that is more straightforwardly even autobiographical. I mean, I can see the irony of that. But I've always been fairly philosophical about these things. And so it hasn't, worry me in a way.
The success with this book, has it changed your life in any way?
No, it hasn't. I wish it had. I wish I'd done something like buy a nightclub or run off with a teenage girl. My life has not changed at all. In a way, that worries me. It should change, and it shows all the signs of going on exactly as before. But, of course, these things take a long time to work through the system, and it may be that my life has changed, but I haven't noticed it yet.
Your life is exactly as before. How is it then?
My life? Well, I lead an extremely quiet life. I live about 20 miles to the west of London in a small suburb. Now that my children have grown up and left home, I write during the day,
go for a walk along the river in the early evening and then watch TV and drink whiskey and soda. And that seems to be the right background for me as an imaginative writer. Perhaps I need an almost invisible... I need invisible surroundings, and this suburb is almost invisible to me. In fact, I went on holiday a few years ago to Greece, and I was there for about a month, and I was standing on a beach in the Peloponnese, and I suddenly forgot where I lived. I couldn't remember. I knew I lived in England, but I couldn't remember where, even though I'd lived then in this house for about 20 years, and I actually had to work it out backwards, you know. Calais, Dover, London, Hammersmith, Shepperton, I suddenly realised, and then this house. So, obviously this house on this quiet suburb where I worked doesn't have a real grip on my imagination. I think its great appeal for me is that it is nowhere, that it represents the minimal context in which I can sort of credibly feel part of a landscape. But it's not one from which I draw anything, imaginatively speaking. In many ways, I feel like a sort of secret agent who assumes a modest disguise, pretends to be a bank clerk living in a suburb. And I feel that to a large extent, I'm probably doing that. I like to think of myself a bit like the surrealist painter Magritte, who led a very bourgeois life in a quiet suburb of Brussels, took his Pomeranian dog for a walk at the same time every afternoon, drank a little coffee in the local cafe and played a game of chess and then went back to this very bourgeois house. I like that. I think that's the perfect background for certain kinds of imagination.
£2 billion for the Distillers Group. A man who tried to murder two 13-year-old girls